Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs classes. So today you have 30th of March 2021. All right, and these classes are basically useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examination, as you require to answer the few questions related to the current affairs. So for that, you must study Current Affairs magazine as well as your daily national newspaper. Okay, and you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, where we are uploading on the day-to-day basis these current affairs lectures. So you can also supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures also. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first question is basically the judicial review. Okay. The judicial review is the process by which the judiciary means we have the Supreme Court, High Court, as well as your district courts, as well as your lower courts. Okay. So power of the judicial review basically have been given by the Constitution to the Honorable Supreme Court. Okay. As well as the High Courts. Okay. As you know, we have integrated judicial system. In the integrated judicial system, what we have at the top level, at the apex level, we have Supreme Court, and at the state level, okay, at the state's level, you have basically the high courts. Okay, so judicial review is the process by which judiciary of India would basically check out the legality of the law. Okay, legality of the law means whether the law is as per the constitutional provision or not. Okay. Whether the competent authority has the competence to frame that law or not. Okay. Whether the law is based on the constitutional provision or not. If it is infringing of it, if it is violating any of the constitutional provision, the Supreme Court as well as the High Court has the power to declare such law null and void. Okay. But these laws which are declared by the Supreme Court as well as the High Court null and void are defined under Article 13, Clause 3. Okay, these laws may be a permanent law, may be a temporary law like ordinance. Okay, the permanent law means that law which have been made by the by the Parliament. That means the Parliament passes the bill and then ultimately assented by the President of India. That makes basically act and ultimately enforce right on the land. So any sort of a law which is permanent in the nature or non-permanent in the nature, that is the bylaw, rule, regulations, notification, customs, anything which have the force of law, that means that have the ability to get enforced, right? Such law would comes under the purview of Article 13, and such law can be declared null and void by the Honorable Supreme Court as well as the High Court. Now, this is all about the judicial review. Now, a public interest litigation, which is known as PIL. Okay. The PIL have been filed in the Supreme Court by a person called Wasim Rizvi. Okay. The person Wasim Rizvi is asking the Supreme Court to declare the 26 verses of the Quran, which is the holy, scripture for the Muslims, as a unconstitutional. So the Wasim Rizvi wants the Supreme Court to declare these 26 verses of the Quran to unconstitutional because he thinks that they violate the constitutional provisions as well as they promote extremism and the terrorism in the country, right? So the PIL is seeking to declare such 26 verses of the Quran unconstitutional. Now, under Indian law, as per the Indian constitution, only the law which comes under the purview of Article 13 can be challenged in the court of the law, and court can declare such law unconstitutional. So Article 13, Clause 3 defines that law, which include any ordinance, okay, which is promulgated by the President of India on the recommendations of the cabinet, any order, any bylaw, any rule, regulations, notification, customs, or any uses that have the force of the law. Only that can be declared null and void. Okay. Now, the law in the force is basically, any sort of a law which is enacted by the competent authority. That means a competent authority should be there, or it has been enacted by the legislature. legislation means either your legislative assembly or your parliament, which have the power to enact the law, right? Either through the passes in the parliament or in the state legislature. Okay, such can be declared null and void. Now, this law under Article 13 do not include the religious scriptures. That means in the definition of the law under Article 13.3 do not include the law which is there, or the provisions or verses or any sort of a, you know, the points which are there in the religious scriptures. For example, in the Quran, in the Gita, Vedas, Bible, Guru Granth Sahib, right? Any such, whatever it is written in those holy books, right? They are not under the purview of Article 13. That means they are not to be included as a law under Article 13, right? Thus, they cannot be challenged. They cannot be challenged in the court of the law because they do not cover under the purview of law. Right. So that is the thing, that under Article 13, they are not challengeable or they cannot be challenged in the court of the law. Right. The divine books that we are talking about, the Quran, Bible, Gita, Guru Granth Sahib, they are the sources of the law. Okay. They are the sources of the law. Based on that, we can frame the law. But they are not law by themselves. Okay. They are not law by themselves. Okay. So the Quran or Gita or Bhagavad Gita or Bible or Guru Granth Sahib, they are not law for the purpose of Article 13. Right. Now, you must understand that various Muslim jurists, right, follows, you know, these holy books, right, through the interpretation. They also take into account the other sources of the law. For example, the Hadith, which means the Prophet saying or Prophet Muhammad saying, right? Then Ijma, which is basically the juristic consensus. Then Qiyas, which is analogous deductions. Urf, the customs. Then Istian, which is juristic preferences. Or Istisla, which is public interest, right? So various Muslim jurists basically follows these, you know, interpretations that have been taken from these holy books. But again, they are not law as per the purview of Article 13, right? So the court cannot, you know, interfere in this in these holy books, because if there is interfering will be done, it will be tantamount to interfering, you know, in the religious affairs of a particular community. Okay, next, the polling agents, right? So now, why this polling agents is in the polling agents? First of all, are basically a person who is appointed, right? As a representative of a political party, right, to the particular polling station. Now, these polling agents basically, you know, have different tasks. They verify that polling is done on the right, you know, as per the law which has been made, right? They check any sort of illegal voting or any sort of, you know, that illegalities which is being carrying out over there. Okay, so they are representative of a political party. Now, the election commission's decision to change the rules for the appointment of these polling agents, right, has sparked the debate in the West Bengal. So certain rules have been changed for the appointment of the political agents in the polling booth, right? So which has led to the, you know, the debate and the ruckus among the political parties. So the polling agent is basically a person who has been a representative of a political party. Because you must understand, for example, if a person is standing in the election and in his constituency, right, let's say 10 polling booths are there, right? So the one person cannot be present in all the 10 polling stations or 10 booths simultaneously to verify, okay, at the day of election, to check whether everything is on the right or not. So to do that task, right, a polling agents are basically appointed. They are the representatives of a political party. They will check, right, as per the law which has been made. So the election commission allows a candidate, okay, whoever is standing in the election, to appoint a polling agent, right? Sorry. So that polling agent will keep the eye on the voting process, entire voting process in that particular polling station. So the role of the polling station, so as per the election commission's rule, right, the polling agent should be first of all familiar with the rules and the procedures, right, which are there for the conducting of the election. Okay, now he should be also aware, right, how the electronic voting machines, that means EVM or VVPATs, voter verified right? Pets, machines which are working, right? He should be aware of all sorts of rules and the procedures, and he should be aware about the working of these machines also, right? So, you know, these voting agents or these polling agents also presents the demonstrations, right? The demonstrations which are arranged by the returning officer of a particular, you know, booth, right? So they basically demonstrate how the functioning of the machines basically working, right? How the operations will be done, right? So the polling agent would be present. If there is any sort of a problem with those machines, these machines are basically getting replaced. Okay. Next, the Uniform Civil Code. Okay. The Uniform Civil Code means it should be a uniform code which will be applicable to every sections of the society, irrespective of caste, creed, or religion, right? It will be applicable to every section of the society in terms of the personal matters like marriage, divorce, right? All sort of things. Okay, so this is what we call the Uniform Civil Code. Now, the current Chief Justice of India, Sarad A. Bobde, basically lauded the Goa's Uniform Civil Code. The Goa is the first state in our country who have formulated this Uniform Civil Code. Okay, so Justice S. A. Bobde, basically taking the reference of the Goa, which have been formed the Uniform Civil Code, has encouraged the intellectuals across the country to indulge in the academic talk. Okay, so to promote such uniform civil codes across the country. And the Justice A. Bobde also asked the intellectuals, right, to kickstart this academic talk, to visit the state, to learn more about the Uniform Civil Code, which is being formed in the Goa state. Okay. Earlier in the September 2019 also, the Supreme Court has described the Goa as the shining example with the Uniform Civil Code. Okay. So I have explained to you the Uniform Civil Code. The Uniform Civil Code is the one which provides the one law for every section of the society, for entire country, which is applicable to all religious communities, whether it is a Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, or Christian. Okay, it is related to their personal matters, like personal matters means the marriage, divorce, inheritance, adoption. It will be, right, it will be uniformly applied with that law. Currently you have, right, the marriage based on the Hindu Marriage Act, the marriage which is based on the Muslim law, right, the based on the Sharia, like that for the Christians, they have their own respect, their own, you know, personal law. So currently each is governed, or each section or each religious community is governed by their own respective religious law. But now this Uniform Civil Code is trying to have one uniform law that will be uniformly applicable to every religious community. Okay. Article 44, which is a part of the Directive Principles of State Policy, that is called DPSP. Okay. But you must understand, these DPSPs are not enforceable in the court of the law, right? But these DPSPs are basically the instructions which are given to the government of the day or the state to implement those provisions. So Article 44 basically provides that the state shall endeavor to secure the Uniform Civil Code for the citizens throughout the territory of the country. That means the Constitution also provides the enabling mechanism by which a uniform civil code should be provided to the entire territory of the country. So the state should strive to have the UCC in that process. Okay. So let's understand the directive principles of the state policy. So first of all, directive principles of the state policy are also called the DPSP. They are enumerated in part 4 of the Constitution. They are not enforceable. Okay, they are not enforceable in the court of the law. That means the person cannot move to the court for their enforcement. Okay, so Article 44 is one such directive principles of the state policy. Okay, Article 37 says that the directive principles of the state policy are not justiciable. Not justiciable means if the person went to the court for their not enforcement of those directive principles of the state policy, the court cannot enforce them, right, in the court of the law, right, because they are not enforceable. Okay, but you must understand these principles are basically the fundamental in the governance of the country. Okay, now Article 44, which I have already explained you, has basically provides that the state shall endeavor, right, that the directive principles or this uniform civil code should be, you know, applicable, right, to the entire country or to the entire territory of the country, right? So, you know, the state should have the obligation, it should have the moral obligation to implement those directive principles of the state policy. Okay. Next, the Heart of Asia, Istanbul process, right? So this Heart of Asia, Istanbul process is basically a mechanism or is an initiative, first of all, right? Promoted by the Afghanistan and the Turkey, okay? Which is a conference, okay? To promote, you know, the peaceful resolution to the conflict of Afghanistan, right? So to develop the Afghanistan holistically. So the Heart of Asia Istanbul process is going to be kickstart, right? In the Istanbul, right? Right. So now the External Affairs Minister Dr. S. Jaishankar reached the Dushanbe, right? On his three-day visit to the Tajikistan. Okay. Now here he will attend the 9th ministerial conference of the Heart of Asia conference. Or Heart of Asia Istanbul process on the Afghanistan. Okay, so the Heart of Asia Istanbul process is basically an initiative which was launched by the Afghanistan and the Turkey. Okay, which is basically launched as a conference which is hosted by the Turkey in the Istanbul on 2nd November 2011. Okay, now under this Istanbul process, the Afghanistan is supported by the 14 participating countries, right, which is located in the Heart of Asia region, okay, as well as the Afghanistan is also supported by the 16 supporting countries, okay, beyond the Heart of Asia region, right, and this Istanbul process is also supported by the 12 regional and the international organizations, right, which has been coordinating in this process, right. So ultimately, the Istanbul process is basically a platform for promoting the regional security, economic and political cooperation, right, which is being centered on Afghanistan, because Afghanistan is basically a restive country where the Talibanis basically govern the country and where the terrorism and all such activities are also very rampant, right? So ultimately, this cooperation or this platform is all about centering on the Afghanistan, right, to resolving the Afghanistan's problem through the dialogue, right, as well as to have the confidence building measures, right, with all stakeholders which are there in the Afghanistan, right, to have the peace and maintain the neutrality on the Afghanistan soil. Okay, the Directorate General of the Regional Cooperation of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Afghanistan is acting as a de facto secretariat of the process, right? So let's understand what is this Heart of Asia region. So Heart of Asia region is basically a geographical area. That means it is having an area which is covering the 15 participating countries of the region. Okay. These 15 participating countries cumulatively consisting of the Heart of Asia region. Okay. Now, this Heart of Asia region is one of the biggest regions in the world. Biggest regions per se. It has the collective geographical area, right, which is around more than 40 million square kilometer, right? If you consider this 40 million square kilometer of that area, which is having around 27% of the land area of the earth. So in that sense that it covers the 40 million square kilometer of the land area, this in terms to the corresponding to the largest or biggest region in the world. Right. Here you have, you know, the Heart of Asia region. Okay. Next, the role of microforest in the disaster management. Okay. So the microforests are basically located all along basically your coastal areas. Now, what happens because of the anthropogenic developmental activities, right? These microforests basically are cleared for the coastal development, right, for habitation purpose, for infrastructure purpose, for other purpose, right? So anthropogenically, they have been cleared. Okay, now what is happening is that if there is any sort of a tsunami, cyclones, or any disaster related to the oceanic waves occur, right, the water can directly entered into the human habitation, right? Previously, if you have the micro forest or the coastal forest areas, these forests basically, you know, it basically cut down the energy of those oceanic tides, waves, and ultimately protects the human habitation. But what is happening is that they have been cleared. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi have underlined the importance of these micro forests, right, to minimize the havoc which is caused by the cyclones in the coastal areas. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi in his Mann Ki Baat program has commended basically two activists. The one is Mr. Vijay Kumar Kavi of the Kendrapara, right, of Orissa. Then Mr. Amrish Samanta of the Paradeep, again in Orissa, right, for their individual effort basically for raising these micro forests, specifically in the coastal villages of the Orissa, right, to protect those villages from the wrath of these high tides, due specifically during the cyclonic time, right? So the Prime Minister in his Mann Ki Baat basically emphasized on creation of such micro forests in the coastal areas because they have the huge greater significance in the state like Orissa, right, which has been witnessing the cyclones every year, right, on the regular basis. So for example, in 2013 you had the cyclone Phailin, then in 2014 you have cyclone Hodod, then you know, in 2018 you have cyclone Titli, you had 2019 you have cyclone Fani, and as well as last year you have 2020 you have cyclone Amphan. So every year you are witnessing in the state of Orissa a one cyclone, which is a cause of the concern, right? So to minimize the havoc which is caused by the cyclone, right, the role of the microforest is immense. So the people should protect their coastal areas by growing these microforests in order to protect themselves from the havoc of those cyclones. All right. Next, the International Ranger Award. Okay. So the International Ranger Award is basically given, right, to the professionals, okay, across the world by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, right, as well as the World Commission on the Protected Areas. So these awards are given to the 10 professionals who are working, right, in the field of the conservation of the forest, right? So from India, the person called Mahendra Giri, which has been a range officer of Rajaji Tiger Reserve Area, right, have been won, right, this International Ranger Award. So the Mahendra Giri, who is the only person who have won this Ranger Award, right, from the international, this International Union for the Conservation of Nature, right, which is also known as IUCN. Yes, so he is the only person from the Asia, right, to win this prestigious International Ranger Award. Okay, so which has been one of the important aspect of, you know, the person who have won this award, right, from India. All right, so let's understand, this award is announced to, you know, by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature as well as the World Commission on the Protected Areas to the 10 professionals across the world. Okay, now this award is developed through the collaboration with International Union of Conservation of Nature, World Commission on the Protected Areas, with the International Ranger Federation, okay, the Global Wildlife Conservation and Conservation Allies. These awards created basically in 2020. Ultimately, aim of these awards to highlight, right, as facilitate the extraordinary work, right, that rangers do in the protected as well as the conserved areas worldwide. So he is the person from Rajaji National Park, Mr. Mahendra Giri. Okay, next, the prorogation. See, prorogation is basically, you know, prorogation means it is completely terminated, right? You know, a particular session, right? So session is terminated. That means the business of session is completed. Okay, the power to prorogation lies with the president. Okay, So president can only do the prorogation, but the power of adjournment or adjournment sine die lies with the presiding officer. Okay. So the presiding officers का मतलब होता है लोकसभा में आपके speaker. In the Rajya Sabha, you have basically, you know, the chairman. Okay. So these are the presiding officers in case of Lok Sabha and in case of Rajya Sabha. So power of adjournment sine die both lies with the presiding officer of the respective house. But the power of prorogation lies with the president of India. So what is the process? Let's say if a session started, okay, let's understand this session. So the, you know, fifth session of the 17th Lok Sabha was started on the 29th of January. Okay. Now what happens is the adjournment sine die means, right? Adjournment sine die means without naming, right? When we are going to meet, the house is basically adjourned for indefinitely. That is called adjournment sine die. The power of doing the adjournment sine die lies with the presiding officer. Now, this is the normal routine in the every session. Now, what happens is within the next few days, normally 3 to 4 days later, the president issues the prorogation. That means it completely terminate the session. Completely terminate the session, right? The new session will begin. Okay. Now, the prorogation basically completes a particular business of a session. Okay. Now, if the termination of a session of the house is done, that is called prorogation, and this power is going, is power given to the president under Article 85, Clause 2. Okay. Now you must understand, president is not, this is not a, the discretionary power of the president, but it is, you know, the president has to act, or president has to do this prorogation on the advice of the prime minister of this country. That means it is not a discretionary power, rather the president exercises this power on the recommendations of the cabinet, which is being headed by the prime minister of this country. Okay. So usually the prorogation follows the adjournment of the sitting, that is adjournment sine die, that I've explained you. Okay. Normally there is a time lag, right, for the adjournment of the house sine die as well as prorogation, generally three to four days or 2 to 4 days, but sometime both can be done simultaneously. Okay. So, you know, houses were prorogued on the same day as well as it was adjourned sine die. So that thing also done, but it depends on, on the recommendations of the prime minister. Whenever the prime minister sent the recommendation to the president immediately prorogued the house. So, you know, but you must understand there is no necessity, or it is not necessary that both the houses should be prorogued simultaneously. Okay. It is not necessary. Okay. Now, this is the, you know, house you can see. Okay. Now, next is exam warriors. So, you know, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have unveiled or launched the new version of Exam Warrior. It is basically a book, right, to make the students stress-free just before the examination. Okay. So, a new version of the Exam Warriors, which are written by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi itself. Okay. Now, this Exam Warrior, or the new version of the Exam Warrior, have the new mantras, right, for the students as well as for the parents to make the students stress-free just right before the examination. Okay. So you can download this, like this version of the Exam Warrior from the retail stores, or you can download it from the online, right? You can also get it from the retail stores, and it is also available, right, on the Namo app, that you can go to the Play Store and you can basically avail this version of, the Exam Warrior. So the new edition of this book, okay, have been enriched with the valuable inputs which have been provided by the students, by the parents, by the teachers. So it is enriched version, which makes it more effective, right? And the substantive new parts have been added to make the students stress-free just before the examination. And it has been specially, taken care of the interest of the parents, teachers, as well as for the students. Okay. Next, the Sabarmati Riverfront Development Project. Now you must understand that Sabarmati is the river which flows through the state of Gujarat. Okay. Now, the Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation is basically you know, a local authority at the urban level, which have made its draft budget for 2021-22, right? This Ahmedabad Municipal Corporation have set aside 1,050 crore rupees, right, for the Sabarmati Riverfront Development Project. This is for the phase two, right, which is going to be begin soon. So to make the riverfront more fascinating for the development of tourism, right, to make it more clean in the holistic development for the tourism purpose, for socio-economic purpose, right, for social purpose, right, this, you know, the Sabarmati Riverfront Development Project is basically the second phase is going to be begin soon. And for that, 1,050 crore rupees have been already set aside. Okay. Now, obviously, the Sabarmati Riverfront is basically the waterfront or the riverfront area, which is being developed along the banks of the Sabarmati River in the Ahmedabad. Okay. It was first proposed in 1960 and the construction for it began in 2005. Right. And the three major objectives of this project is basically the environmental improvement, the social infrastructure, the sustainable development. Okay. Now you must understand that, you know, how this riverfront development is going to be taken place. So first of all, you have to channelize the river to the constant width, that is 263 meters along the part of the passes through the Ahmedabad city. Right. And for that, 204 hectares have been reclaimed already along the 11 kilometer stretch of the Sabarmati Riverfront for the first phase of the project, obviously on the both banks of the river Sabarmati. So it will look like this. Okay. Next, the unique land parcel identification number. So it is based on the Aadhaar number. So this unique land parcel identification number is basically a new project which is being implemented, okay, across the country. Now, what is happening is that the central government is planning to have the 14 digit identification number, right, for every plot of the country in the year. So for every plot, right, the central government is planning to have the unique identification number. This unique identification number will be provided to, you know, to every plot in the country which has been there, right? It is based on, you know, it is based on basically the parameter that the every land is basically having the unique set of identity. So for the every land, a unique number is being provided, and this unique number would basically identify a particular land or particular plot in the country. Okay, now it is basically based on the recommendations which have been given by the Parliamentary Standing Committee. So Parliamentary Standing Committee basically submitted the report to the Lok Sabha last week. Okay. The Parliamentary Standing Committee basically recommended that there should be, you know, the 14 digit identification number for every single land or every single plot in our country. And that database should be integrated with the revenue court records, the bank records, as well as the Aadhaar number. That means this 14 digit identification number would be integrated with the revenue court records, bank records, as well as the Aadhaar number, you know, on the voluntary basis, right? The ultimate idea of this having this uniform or unique land partial identification number is basically, you know, to have remove all such complications in the land consolidation, as well as to remove the duplicacy in terms of the land allotment process. So initially, this ULPIN would be launched in the 10 states in the year 2021, and this will be rolled out across the country by March 2022. Okay, so it will be rolled out, and it is basically done by the Department of Land Resources, okay, which is being carried out on the recommendation of the Standing Committee on the Rural Development. Okay, now an official with the Department of Land Resources basically provides that this integration with the Aadhaar, right, which will uniquely identify the land which will be surveyed, right, and it will basically prevent any sort of a land fraud, specifically in the rural areas or rural India where the land records are outdated and the disputed. Okay, So to remove all such discrepancies regarding this land fraud, right, this unique land identification number would be benefiting, right, to specifically to the rural areas, right, and it will also help in the updation of the land records also. So this identification of the land parcels will be based on the longitude and the latitudes of the land parcel, right? That means the longitude and latitude of the land parcel would be identified, and it is basically dependent on the detailed survey which will be carried out, okay? And you will have the geo referred cadastral maps for this analyzing of this, the land survey, okay? And you must also understand it is the next step in the Digital India Land Record Modernization Program, which is already started in 2008. Okay, so under the Digital Land Record Modernization Program, the digital land records will be made. So it will be made in the online form, right? Anyone can access. It will be easier for the authorities like revenue courts, for the banks, for land authorities, for the local administration to check any sort of a fraud related to the land records. Okay, now the department has taken several initiatives under the program called the National Generic Documents Registration System. Okay, so under this, the ULPIN will be integrated. It will link the code to the land records. Okay, and this integration will be done based on the consent. That means the consent of the people will be taken. Okay, it will be based on the consent of the farmers. It will be based on the consent of the people who are basically given the consent for the recording of such, the land records. So it will be integrated with the Aadhaar number, with the land records, and it will be extended beyond 2021-20 to the 2023-24. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you very much for attending this session. We will meet tomorrow for next current affairs. Thank you.